bidding on free t-shirts, one more day of that laundry.
Okay.
And then the warning into chapter six, come about life in the early statehood period in Arkansas, period between 1836 and secession 1861. Do we have any questions on anything so far? So we have 3 weeks left of class time. Statehood period in Arkansas and some of the disastrous economic decisions such as the real estate bank, the Bank of Arkansas option of going belly up, costing the state very dearly. And we touched on the economy of Arkansas, it's primarily agricultural. It can be agricultural for a very long period of time. One problem that Arkansas had to face was the problem of flooding. There were going to be major floods across the state, and in the early statehood period, there was not a lot that the people were able to do about it. Arkansas, Wachita, or St. Francis, if there was flood, have entire farms be wiped out. A great deal of damage to property, loss of livestock, crops, and even lives. And from 1840 flood in Chico County decided to take upon itself to start building levees to try to control the course of rivers during flooding. After embarking on a very ambitious project, and Chico County is going to be fairly rich in those days because of it's a plantation. They built 110 miles of levees, about 2.5 to 3 feet high, about 10 to 12 foot barriers. It is the river here, every levee, 10 to 12 feet across this way, about 2.5 to 3 feet this way. Gave the area some amount of protection from flooding. The problem is, though, every now and then you get those 100-year floods, the rivers overflow these planks, overflow these levees, to be wiped out. Every now and then they have to go out and repair and rebuild. The agriculture came to develop in Arkansas, particularly in cotton production. Say Arkansas is a major cotton production state, particularly in the southern parts of the state. In 1840, Arkansas was producing 15 bales per 100 people. Again, that's a lot of cotton, but not nearly enough what the states like Louisiana and Mississippi were producing. 1860 increased considerably to 84 bales. The problem here again is just the nature of Arkansas. It is there's nothing wrong with the soil. It's as rich as any southern state. Nothing wrong with the production techniques. It's the same being used all over the country. The problem is again just the population. Just simply not enough of it. Too few people in too wide an area trying to cultivate all this land, and just they're not producing as much in other states. As we had touched on, Arkansas was a slaveholding state. And cotton is one of those major slave-based agricultural crops. It is a very labor-intensive crop, requiring constant maintenance, very difficult to bring in, harvest, and process for market. So the cotton gin, mention of the cotton gin in 1797, made the process of processing cotton a lot easier, which helped increase cotton production across the South. Still very labor intensive. And says again, it required an almost constant supply of labor. And as most large farm owners, most any businessmen, they're going to try to keep their costs as low as possible. So, lowest possible labor cost meant slavery. Owning new things. You don't have to pay them anything, you don't have to treat them any way you want to. The entire paradox of Southern law and Southern culture of the pre-Civil War era is slaves are obviously human beings, walking, talking, same hopes, fears, feelings as anybody else, but by law, noted from this desk, law treats them just the same. And anything and everything be done with slaves with absolutely no repercussions from the law. In some areas of slave, the major slave rebellions, right? We have no records of any kind of major slave uprising in Arkansas. The reason for that probably is simply, well, banana planter is a viewpoint of luck. And from a slave's standpoint, opportunity. Right, slaveholders in the state that has a reasonably high about average compared to other surrounding states. In Union County, for example, there are 42 planters in the state up to the point before the Civil War. Now, planter is traditionally defined as someone who owned 20 or more slaves. These are the upper classes, the very well-to-do. Slaves are very expensive to own, but they have a lot of them, means you have a lot of money to go around. And in Union County, these 42 planters own an average of 38 slaves. And had an average size plantation of about 2,019 acres. But again, the most intense production of cotton and most intense concentration of slaves was in eastern Arkansas. So the most area of the most intense concentration of slaves was in Chico County. I'll give you a map here. Arkansas County is 1860. A lot more counties are to fill in at this point. You now have Columbia County in here, kind of separated from a piece of the Union and Lafayette. Ashley County's come along. Chico County basically taking a lot more of still taking a lot of the southeastern Arkansas. It's a lot more of what it does today, but the fairly large area. That largest plantations off the south were along the Mississippi River. because of, you have that frontage of the river itself, the very rich soil, very special area. And have a briefly get to climate as you get to further and further south. Now, Chico County, for example, has 83 planters. With an average of 81 slaves. On 2,051 acres. See, much richer county compared to Union County, almost twice as many planters to have a lot more money to go around, so they have before these large levee projects. In Chico County, you need it. These large plantations, they often have a much more rigid separation of races. Okay, so these large ones, you might have slaves kind of form their own communities. Basically, the planters will give them the tools to build their own houses, a little more just a little huts, and kind of live separately from the main plantation house. Smaller farms and maybe only one or two slaves. The slaves might be living inside the house with the farm family, or side by side with them. But of course, if it's being their slaves, being sold at any point in time. Now, these larger plantations, it's of course not going to be the slave owners actually doing the work or overseeing the slaves, but they hire out a manager called an overseer who oversees the slaves and fills out all the punishments of the slaves as that overseer would see fit. Give you a couple of numbers here. According to the 1860 census, go back to the census because those are really the best records we have. The diaries and newspapers are very helpful, but they're not always entirely accurate. Census is the federal government going by and asking everyone all sorts of questions. The 1860 census, it was how many people live in your household, what are their names, what are their ages, what do you do for a living, how much money do you have. And there's also one special box. Are you blind, deaf, or dumb? Are insane. And every now and then you find somebody check, yes, check, blind, yes, check, insane, check, whatever. Now for slaveholding states like Arkansas, you'd have two lists of the census. One would be called the pre-schedule list of all the free inhabitants. And the slave schedule, which was all the list of all the slaves, had the slave owner's name, and the names of the slaves he had. Their ages up. The 1860 census is important because it's the last census for the Civil War. Civil War historians use this all the time, 1860 census all the time, to figure out more information about men who fought in the Civil War. So they would tell pretty much how close, how old they were, where they came from, and what they did for a living before the war. And sometimes you can get some information on slaves, but since slaves don't have last names in most cases, it's kind of hard to get a very accurate kind of reading. Sometimes you can get more information on them. The 1860 census, Arkansas had a total population of 435,000. Slave population of 111,000. 26%. In 1840, this proportion was at 19%. As Arkansas developed, more slaves brought in proportionate to the population. Again, most of the population stays based in the southern and eastern parts of the state. There had been 52% of the population in 1840. 59% of the population now is based in the lowlands of Arkansas. How about that? 87% of all slaves. So again, eight out of every nine slaves in Arkansas is in the southern eastern parts of the state. Again, this is because of the geographic makeup of Arkansas. In the northern western parts of Arkansas, the Boston Mountains, the Ozarks, you're just simply not going to have a lot of the kind of agriculture that supports slavery. Simply just, it's very difficult to maintain. Very difficult to produce cotton in the rocky hillside. You can't produce tobacco there either, or sugar. You may notice there aren't a lot of rice paddies around Bentonville. So, therefore, not need a very large labor force. Therefore, there are very few slaves and very few slaves in northwestern Arkansas. And that pattern's kind of continued to this day. This is why most of the largest concentration of African Americans in the state is in still today the southern eastern parts of the state. Still playing very not because an African American so much work in agriculture anymore, just because it's where the families have always lived. Like anybody's family, a lot of times they don't stray too far from where you're from. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Per capita income in Arkansas in 1860 was $73.86. Considerably low compared to today's standards, but a lot of the states still working on subsistence farming and not producing for those markets, not to produce for themselves. Cotton is producing millions of dollars for the state every year. Four times what the corn production is. Sorry, if you got cotton production worth four times as much as corn production, of course you're going to be going more toward cotton if you have the means to produce it. And get to 1844, and get back into the political situation here. 1844, start seeing more of the state's politics starting to develop. At the 1844 election, Edward is essentially another standard Arkansas type election. This time period is going to be the Whigs against the Democrats. Now, Party and the Democrats, this essentially was the two major political parties at that time. The Whigs, kind of hard to put a real strong ideological stance on them, but essentially what they had in common was they're against Andrew Jackson and all of Andrew Jackson's policies. Democrats favor Jackson and his policies. They still had kind of this kind of personalist politics. And since the Democrats had been a party in ascendancy during the territory period, the later territorial governor appointed by Jackson. Jackson get appointed his allies. Jackson allies his territorial delegates. The state's leaders came to identify the Democrats. And those opposing that faction, which was, of course, Crittenden. So they became identified with the Whig Party. I'd say the division is not quite the same as modern day Democrat and Republican, but you kind of see elements of their constituencies today in this original arrangement. Democrats generally favored by immigrants. This time Roman Catholics voted overwhelmingly for the Democrats, and not so much today. The Whigs tend to be favored more by evangelical Protestants, what we call today the religious right. Middle and lower classes tend to vote for Democrats, upper classes tending to vote for Whigs, but not necessarily. Now the Whigs, they generally have this kind of a upper class orientation. Most of their strength is in the southern parts of the state. Now, you do have some Whig voting strength in northwestern Arkansas, primarily because you have a fair number of opponents of Democratic policies in the rest of the state based in northwestern Arkansas, being that the rest of the state kind of oriented more toward the lowlands, politics, policies that trying to benefit the lowlands at the expense of the highlands in northwestern Arkansas. So they came with to kind of make their voices a little bit more better heard. But the state was overwhelmingly Democratic. As they discussed, you have a large strength of the Whigs in the southeastern parts of the state. It's not necessarily mean that they're always going to be winning those areas. A lot of times they didn't. A lot of times the Whigs have not been in northwestern Arkansas. That's simply where they tend to have the largest concentration. Well, 1844, had kind of an odd election. Archibald Yell is stepping down so he can run for Congress. Very popular governor, and people of Arkansas think of the place where Yale really is in Congress. You know, where you get to Yale County and Yaleville from. And so the Democrats are trying to find a replacement candidate. So the Democrats initially choose Elias N. Conway, their candidate governor. Again, based on a convention. But this Conway doesn't quite have what the kind of political gifts that the other Conways had. Having state party leaders start telling from the reports from over the state that Elias Conway just isn't quite catching on. So fearing he might lose, they kind of pushed Conway out of the way and and Daniel Chapman, who had been the candidate for another office, made the candidate for governor. Chapman gets sick, too sick to campaign, so he drops out. And so the Democrats finally end up going with Thomas Drew, their third candidate for the campaign season. Well, the Whigs have managed to stay with just one candidate, Lorenzo Gibson. Hot Springs. And the Whigs think their chances are going to be very good this year in 1844. They have a very important they have a very popular candidate, Henry Clay, running for president. I think with him and Gibson together, they might be able to carry the state. Democrats are very badly divided. They got all this mess over trying to find a candidate for governor. Now, Whigs are showing a lot of strength along the Mississippi River, also in some of the inland counties like Jefferson, Bradley, Pulaski, White County, and the Arkadelphia Hot Springs area. And so they're expected to be able to do fairly well, cutting in a lot of the Democratic strongholds in the southwestern parts of the state. But the Democrats send kind of shifting their strength to the northern parts of the state and the southwestern parts of the state. Approved a very surprising election result. The Democrats end up edging out to Gibson. And not necessarily because of any kind of special gifts, political gifts that Thomas Drew had, but simply because one thing Gibson couldn't find to pull it off, Whigs didn't have that much strength. And a third party independent candidate ran, as he was an independent, which kind of cut in the Whig's strength. See, in any election, there's a latent anti-incumbent vote. Sometimes it's stronger than others, but depending on the makeup of the voting, the characteristics of the voters, popularity of the candidate, strength of the issues. And there was enough of an anti-incumbent vote that might have been able to oust the Democrats, but Gibson and the independents essentially divided those votes, which gave the election to Thomas Drew, won by a very narrow vote. Like I said, the whole politics of the early part of the state is going to be dominated by Democrats. It still is largely to this day. But still, the most important part, most important component of Democratic politics in the pre-Civil War era is this thing, Conway. The Conway family, Conway's and Sevier, are going to control Democratic politics in the state up to the Civil War. By controlling the Democratic Party, they're going to be controlling the whole state of Arkansas. It's arrangement known as the family, also known as the dynasty. You can see most of the early governors of the state are either going to be Conways or related to Conways or political allies. Now, essentially, since you have one family, one group controlling the Democratic Party, to get anywhere in the state politics, statewide, you had to be very closely allied with the dynasty, which kind of rankled some people because the Democrats were, because a lot of people didn't like this idea, this big boss machine kind of politics where one group is controlling everything. I think kind of undemocratic. Now, since the Conways and Sevier's kind of controlled the whole of works, and by and large were an honest bunch, and delivered all the promises, what a whole lot anybody should do pretty much dislodge them. This idea that there's this only one group and only one group controlling the politics is kind of bothersome. And so I'll give you some of the names here. Three out of the first governors of the state were Conways or Conway cousins. James Conway, Elias Conway, become governor later on, and Henry Rector. So the first senator is Ambrose Sevier, for his senator is a related of the Conways. Now, Archibald Yale had gone off to Congress, and Yale, like so many other, was a Conway ally. Yale had become a popular figure, just a kind of forced personality, the ability to kind of deliver on the goods. He was from Tennessee, like the Conways and Sevier's. He came to Arkansas in 1834. And the state is the leading proponent of statehood. But Yale had this kind of independent streak there that he liked. And very close to the Conways and Sevier's liked him. But he had his own kind of independent power base, particularly, for instance, from the northwestern part of the state. I gave him some kind of leeway. He didn't have to do everything the family asked him. Worked together on a lot of issues, but he worked on his own on a lot of issues. And on top of that, Yale had a very important source of support to top of all these others, Andrew Jackson. The fact that Democrats, by invoking the name Jackson, could get them a long way in a lot of areas. Yale, is kind of a colorful man. Being kind of a frontier politician, wasn't one given a lot of niceties. He was the kind of guy you'd see these $1,000 plate fundraisers. He was the kind of guy to be out to kind of get his hands dirty with the common man of Arkansas. The politics was kind of a rough and tumble kind of business these days, and Yale could give and take with the best of them. This is a time when the voting sites were not in churches and community centers and elementary schools. This is a time when polling places were in bars and livery stables and other unsavory places, which is partly why women did not have the right to vote, because a lot of men saying, well, we cannot take our women to these kinds of places. One clever biographer said that Archibald Yale could, like Bradley, could out-talk, out-drink, out-shoot, and out-pray any opponent he had. Really, he could. Now, those kind of skills, he got a long way in frontier here in Arkansas. As he ran for Congress in 1844, resigning from Congress originally, resigning as governor so he could run for that seat. Placed very briefly by Samuel Adams, who was the president of the Senate. Sorry about the remainder of 1844. Ironically, publicly, though, of when y'all resigned to run for Congress, gave the Whigs the one opportunity they had to show any kind of strength they had in the state. There are five candidates running to their original territorial delegate had to step down, had to resign in 1844. Had like a 3-week time period the territorial delegate would have to serve in the meantime when the Roosevelt remained of the term and for the new territorial delegate to come in. So it had to hold special elections, the guy would only be serving for 3 weeks. Five people running statewide with one territorial delegate, but the U.S. congressional seat, just so they can be congressman for 3 weeks. Four Democrats, one Whig. The Democrats eviscerate each other in the election, and the Whigs, the one Whig candidate, ends up winning by 200 votes statewide. The only time the Whigs won a statewide election in Arkansas, to serve in a congressional seat for 3 weeks. Now, leading figures behind the Whig Party were Crittenden. He tried to revive his political fortunes by aligning with the Whigs, had very little success with it, and Albert Pike. See here on page 116. Crittenden continued to lose, leaving his leader of the Whig Party. Crittenden just kind of gives up, wanders off, and hands leadership over to Albert Pike. Pike's kind of a colorful character. He supported Henry Clay, the